Avenue Baptist Church, and if you're here as a visitor, we bid you welcome and thank you for coming. And what a joy to be here. It's a great day today to serve the Lord. Let me ask you folks a question. Do you ever write things in your Bible? We had a wonderful brother who died some years back by the name of Leonard Clay, and I would love to have had his Bible after he passed away. He had more notations and comments written in his Bible than I would love to have had that just to study it. But the reason I ask you that question, he said that in September the 17th, 2006. Now, if my math is right, today is September the 18th, 2016. And I believe if I subtract one from the other, that's 10 years, is it not? And I thank this pastor for 10 years of service to his Lord and to his people. And I would say if you have an opportunity today, thank him. Tell him you appreciate him. He is a wonderful pastor, and he has blessed me more than I could begin to tell you. But 10 years of service, and I know who he longs to please. He wants to please his Lord. And I am proud that he is my pastor. So, but if you would, stand with us today. Over in the book of James, the Lord tells us if we'll draw near to him, he will draw near to us. Hymn number 290 is the number. Turn to it, and we're going to sing the first, the second, and the fourth verse. I am thine, O Lord. Everybody ready? I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Here we go, church. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious. Verse number 2, consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw. I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Sing it, church. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side.
Remain standing for prayer. Remember the Randy Goodrow family. We will have his memorial service tomorrow at 6 p.m. at the Appalachian Funeral Home. They'll be receiving friends from 4 to 6. That's Connie Barnes's brother. He got sick, 4 weeks ago, went to the doctor, and last Tuesday he graduated. So you think you're walking around healthy many times, and bam, in less than a month, you are gone. Remember that family. Doris Butler, Betty Hamilton. She's home from the hospital, went home yesterday. Continue to pray for the Tent Crusade in Robbinsville, North Carolina. Last Wednesday night, over 100 professions of faith on the Wednesday night. And there's been multitudes of, they set all the chairs out. They went and borrowed chairs, and then people were standing on the outside of a tent. Somewhere between 2,500 and 3,000 people. In a county with 8,000 people, for the crusade there. The Montgomery family, Seth is, and the families took some time off, and just pray for them that God give them grace during the time of their sorrow. Jay Mullinex, Jay had surgery this week. He's home. Lorraine said he wasn't doing too well, but continue to pray for Jay. Brother Charles Miller, been praying for him. Charles, good to see you today.
Amen.
Welcome back to church today. Pray for Brother Biggs. Brother Charles, he's preaching at Gravel Hill. He's filling in for Pastor Montgomery today. And then Sister Brenda Manuel had some surgery this week, and she's not doing well. Let's remember her. How many of you got needs? Well, listen, let's take these needs to the Lord this morning in prayer. Ask God to work as He only can. Brother Scott, would you pray for us this morning? Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. And amen. Come on up, choir, and we invite you to come and join us to sing if you haven't before. We'd love to have you. The Bible says, faint not, fear not, fret not. We look around this world, we're concerned. We don't have to be concerned because we know who holds tomorrow. Storms in your life recently? Gone through any tough times? Had some health problems, whatever it may be? Lost a loved one? We're all going to go through storms. Either you've come out of one or you're going into one. But this song says, just hold on till the storm passes by. Praise God, it will.
Amen.
Okay.
Follow the sun.
You know, there was a time when Jesus stood looking down upon Jerusalem, and he wept and he cried, "Jerusalem, oh Jerusalem, if only you had come to me, I would have gathered you under my wings." Lavonda sings a wonderful song, "Under His Wings." And I thought of this song here. There's so much unknown in the world today, so much confusion. It's perplexing, but this song says, "I'm sheltered in the arms of God." Amen. This is something special, I think. I call this the Ladies Oakland Avenue Quartet. And we're kind of semi-barefoot, and sometimes we're not. These ladies have a song that just has blessed my heart to hear them sing it. And it's simply called, I Have Been Blessed.
Carson, it's I have been blessed. Do you see that anywhere? It is a CD somewhere. A CD.
Maybe we better do it tonight. What do you think? Let's
do it.
We can't.
We'll do it tonight.
I apologize. We can't locate the CD. It's my fault. It's not to Carson. We didn't. My bad. That's my bad. But I promise we'll do it tonight. If all the ladies will be back tonight. I was looking forward to that, but we'll have to hold off.
Okay. Number 334.
Tell you what, I was listening, looking forward to that. Pastor often says that there is no victory until you're assured of your salvation. I mean, how can you have victory? How can you serve the Lord if you're really not sure you're saved? It makes common sense. It's good preaching. It makes common sense. So I love this song that Miss Fanny Crosby did. I think it's my favorite. It's called Blessed Assurance. Jesus is mine, and we all need that assurance of knowing that Christ lives in our hearts. Stand with us. 334 is the hymn number. Blessed Assurance. Jesus is mine. Is he yours today?
Blessed Assurance. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a fortress.
Sing it.
Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story.
coming down, remain standing. Be sure to greet one another, especially those visiting. Tell somebody you love them.
Well, good morning, and we welcome you today to Oakland Avenue Baptist Church, and what a joy it is to welcome those that are visiting with us today. What happened to the usher on the left-hand side? We got the usher here. If you're visiting with us today, as they walk back, just lift your hand up. They'll give you a visitor's packet. And inside that visitor packet, there's a card, and we'd ask you to fill it out. We'd love to have a record of your visit. And we do welcome those that are visiting with us today. May God richly bless you. Let me again make the announcement. Randy Goodrow funeral will be at 6 tomorrow at Appalachian. They'll be receiving friends from 4 to 6. And then latest prayer time on Monday evening at 6 o'clock, Wednesday night Bible study, Romans chapter number 6. And then Thursday night here at the church at 7 o'clock for prayer meeting. And out in the vestibule, there is a list of needs for the people in West Virginia. We hope to have a couple of tractor and trailer load of material to take the people in West Virginia from the Tri-City area, the churches. I'm telling you, these people in West Virginia, they are in dire help, man, I'm telling you. They're living in tents. They're trying to get places, people's trying to help them build homes back. How'd you like to wake up one day, everything you had is gone, home, everything. And get a list back there in the vestibule, and we've got this evening and Wednesday evening to get it here, put it over in the fellowship hall in the left-hand corner. And then Thursday, I need some people to come and help me package everything that we've got in boxes and label it so that we can put it on the tractor, on the trailers, and the bags and all, that it'll bust open and all that's been brought in. So we've got to package it into boxes. So if you could help me on Thursday, we sure would appreciate that. And homecoming next Sunday. And we're looking forward to homecoming, and we've got the barbecue man coming back, and we're having barbecue chicken and baby back ribs. Do you like them Carolina style, Chattanooga style, Georgia style? We're having the ribs next Sunday, so Brother Clyde's going to do several different flavors of the ribs and the chicken. So remember homecoming, invite your family, friends, loved ones, and bring them to homecoming next Sunday, okay? And I might preach that sermon next Sunday. Something you've never saw before that you see, but you'll never see again. Amen. So don't that get your curiosity up? Now, I don't know that I will, but it's a sermon God brought back from years ago. I hadn't thought of this sermon in probably 20 years, but it's been a long time since I've used it, so I don't know. All right, men, come, we'll receive the morning giving. Thursday evening. To pack up the stuff, 10 o'clock. You're Baptist, aren't you? So it takes you a long time to wake up, so 10 o'clock. All right, let's look to the Lord and ask the blessing day. Well, Jeff Allison, would you pray for us? Amen. I invite you to take your Bibles this morning and turn with us to the book of Ephesians, chapter 4. Ephesians, chapter 4. Our scripture text this morning is found in verse 4 through 6. I simply want to speak to you this morning on this thought. One. Have you ever heard a message on one? How many of you are students of numerology in the Bible? I would encourage you sometime to just realize there's a great study in the scriptures on numbers. It's called the study of numerology. Every number has a meaning, and there's a lot of significant numbers in the Bible. You know, that's just like number 5 is the number of grace, 6 is the number of man, 7 is the number of God. 8 is the number of new beginnings. 11, the number of chaos and confusion. How many of you know 9/11? On 9/11, there was 11 letters in Afghanistan, 11 letters in Saudi Arabia. Where did they hit? In New York City, the towers looked like what? 11. The number 11 is a significant number of confusion and chaos. And that day was a day of confusion and chaos in America on 9/11. There's a lot that we could deal with, but numbers are important. We're dealing with one this morning. One. One is a very interesting number in the Bible. One is the number in the Bible that stands for unity. Unity is a very important doctrine in the Bible. How many of you know if we're bound together, we're stronger than if we're divided? Are we a united America or a divided America? We are a divided country. And when you divide, you weaken yourself instead of strengthening yourself. The church needs to be united. God's people needs to be united. Listen to me, folks. It's not the church down the streets, our enemy. It's not those that are preaching the word of God. They might see things a little different than what we see, but we as God's people ought to be united together. As a child growing up in the mountains of North Carolina, we went to Mountain View Baptist Church on Bad Creek. But I remember my dad taking us down to the Presbyterian Church on Rock Creek when they'd have their special services and all, and revivals. I remember going to Red Hill to the Methodist Church, Beans Creek to the Free Will Baptist Church. I'm going to tell you something. As a child, I can't remember a whole lot of difference in going to the different churches. I tell you, I believe they had Christ, and I'm afraid today we might have denominations. I want to be united in Christ, don't you? And that's what it's all about. And the word one is bringing unity. Now, look at the scripture this morning that the Lord has given us for the message. Verse 4 of Ephesians 4. There is one body and one spirit, even as you're called, in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. He's speaking to the saved, to the redeemed that has Christ in their life. Shall we pray and ask God to minister to our hearts today? Father, we bow in your presence and we thank you for the privilege of gathering here in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray he, the Holy Spirit, would illuminate our minds and our hearts to the truth that you have for us today. Lord, help us to realize it's important to hear what God has to say. We sung that song this morning, Draw Near. And Lord, I believe every one of us can get just as close to you as we want to. And I believe you want us to snuggle up close to you this morning. I believe you want us to realize that you're the Lord and we need to put you in the center of our lives. Now, Lord, minister to us as thy word is proclaimed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. One typhoid germ can contaminate 1 million gallons of pure water. One misstep to a mountain climber can plunge him to his death. One blood clot to the heart can stop the heart. One little speck of steel to the eye can put the eye out. One misunderstanding can break a relationship. One wrong cut of the steering wheel can send you into an accident. One drink of liquor can send you down to a life of misery. Listen, I hear people say, if I hadn't have took the last drink, I wouldn't have been drunk. I got a better advice for you. If you never take the first, then you'll not have to worry about being drunk. Amen. One time with drugs can send you down to a life of misery and sadness and sorrow. One time of immoral living can change your whole life. Just one day without prayer and Bible reading and study can send your life into a state of apathy and complacency and coldness and indifference. Just one time laying out of church can send you down to a path that draws you away from the things of God. Just one match can burn the forest down. Did you ever think about this? You can't have two until you have one. You can't have two until you have one. Let's think about this thing of one this morning. Look in our text this morning. There is one God. Verse number 6, it says, one God, one God. I like the words that our Lord spoke in the book of Mark in chapter number 12 and verse number 32.
Mark chapter 12 and verse number 32. He said, "And the scribe said unto him, Well, Master, thou hast said the truth, for there is one God, and there is none other but me." Folks, listen this morning. There's only one true and living God. There's a lot of false gods. There's the gods that man has created. But there's only one God that created everything. He's known as Elohim, Yahweh, Jehovah, the Almighty Creator and Sustainer of heaven and earth. He is known as the Sovereign One in control. He is known as the one that holds all the universe in His power and His control. I said to my Sunday school class this morning, there's one doctrine that keeps me from losing my mind, and it's the sovereignty of Almighty God. God's in charge this morning, folks. There's one God that is in charge. And I'm grateful I know that one God. I'm grateful that I know that I can cast my burdens and my cares upon Him. I'm grateful that I know I have a relationship with Him through His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm grateful that I have fellowship and I have communion with Him. I'm grateful that I know that He'll lead me in the path of righteousness for His name's sake. I'm glad that I can commit my way unto Him and lean not unto my own understanding. I'm glad that I know in this one and true God that I am more than a conqueror through Him. I'm grateful this morning that I know that I have His grace and His peace and His power in my life. I'm glad that there's one God, and I'm glad that I know Him. Amen. The true and the living God, the Lord God Almighty. But there's one sin that, look in Romans chapter 5 and verse number 12. Romans chapter 5 and verse number 12. One sin. As I said a while ago, one typhoid germ in a million gallons of pure water contaminates the water. And just one sin contaminates our life. Just one sin makes our life unfit. And look at what Romans chapter 5 and verse 12 said. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. One sin. I talk to people and talk to them about being saved and talk to them about going to heaven and have peace with God and the peace of God. And I have many people many times ask them, well, preacher, I'm a good person. Preacher, I live a good life. And I ask them a question, have you ever sinned? If you've ever sinned, that doesn't make you good then, does it? That makes you a what? A sinner. You know, I talk to people and they say, well, preacher, I pay my bills and I do all. I have people say, well, preacher, I'm better than the people who go down to your church. I want to ask you a question. Are you as good as God is? See, folks, if we'd stop and realize, sin has messed us up. Sin has messed us up. I want to ask you something. If you realize you're messed up, doesn't it just make sense to get out of the mess? Huh? I don't know where we logically think anymore or not. Matter of fact, sometimes I don't know even where we think or not. Somebody said we only use 2% of our minds. I said most folks that I see today don't even be using 2% of their minds. Doesn't it just logically think if we're in a mess, we ought to get out of the mess? What's the problem? The problem is sin. The problem is sin. I mean, listen, look around this room this morning. Glasses, hearing aids, false teeth. Most of us are falling apart, right? Why are we falling apart? Because of Romans 5:12. Sin entered into the human race. Listen, folks, one sin caused all the mess that we're in. And we all sinned and come short of the glory of God and realize there is one God. And if I've ever sinned one sin against God, that makes me what? Guilty in the presence of God Almighty. There's one God, there's one sin, but there's one door out of this mess. And that door is the Lord Jesus Christ. John chapter 10. If you'd like to turn with me to the book of John chapter 10. And look at this 10th chapter. There's a door that delivers from sin. There's a door that delivers from the mess that we're in. If all of a sudden you realized this building was on fire up here, how many of you know there's no doors in the back of this church? The doors are where? In the front of the church. In the front of the church. How many of you, if you realized that this place was on fire, how many of you would make an exit through the door? Well, all of you just going to sit in here and burn up, aren't you? Huh? You're going to sit there and look at them and roast marshmallows, aren't you? Fix hot dogs while it's burning. No. The only way you sit there is you don't realize the place is on fire. And see, the reason you won't walk through the door of salvation, and the reason you won't walk through the door of the mess that the human race is in, is because you will not realize and admit there's a mess. And I need to be delivered from this sin. I need to be delivered from this corruption that I'm living in. And there's only one door for deliverance. There's only one door to escape sin. There's only one door to heaven. And that is the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at John chapter 10 and verse